Jeffrey Poelvoorde. He received his bachelor's degree in political science and journalism from Northern Illinois University, his master's in political theory and constitutional law from Northern Illinois, and a PhD in political theory, constitutional law, and American political thought from the University of Virginia. And you probably will find it interesting that his dissertation topic was executive privilege, executive power, and the Constitution. And quite appropriate for today's topic of impeachment.
Thank you. And I would like to thank Provost Barker for the opportunity to do something which I think is both publicly necessary and also a private joy for me. William Gladstone, the great English Prime Minister, said of the U.S. Constitution, it was the greatest work of the mind of man ever wrought in a single time and place, and a lifetime of preoccupation with the Constitution's creation and how it is unfolding by our somewhat trivial politics at times for 229 years has been a lifetime of joy and concern. So it's a delight for me to be able to address the meaning of the Constitution on this most important day. Now, when I did this 2 years ago, the topic was, what would Hamilton do, given the kind of interesting, unusual unfoldments in the 2016 election cycle. Now, it also happened that there was a remarkably appropriate artistic event that emerged at the same time, the musical Hamilton. And so Wendy Arms gracefully added some substance to my program 2 years ago by doing some numbers from Hamilton. So we talked briefly about the possibility of her doing a musical impeachment interview. And to quote Dr. Barker, he wasn't aware of the fact that there was a burgeoning a popular genre of impeachment songs. Now, there are obviously three, 2.5 divine hands in my standing in front of you. One was the hurricane that hit Charlotte and missed Spartanburg evidently, but as you're gonna see, this would have been yesterday, which would have been more historically appropriate. The second hand of God was just pointed out to me by God's assistant, Provost Barker, that were nearly dressed identically. So,
you look exactly alike.
Now, there's no reason to insult that man. And the third coincidence was when Wendy and I were thinking about possible impeachment songs, the same song came to us almost instantaneously. I was at services at the synagogue in Spartanburg when a kind of a vision opened up. And I thought, what would be an appropriate song? And of course, it would have been Hit the Road, Jack, sung by Ray Charles and the Raylettes, done by Percy Mayfield. So Wendy has put together an appropriate musical introduction for our topic.
Hit the Road, Jack. I'm not singing that. When Poelvoorde told me that he was speaking on impeachment, I was very puzzled because I couldn't think of anything. He said, "Would you have to sing something from Hamilton?" And I said, "What can I do?" I'm like, "Well, I could sing Same Note of This, but that's kind of a touchy note to do, so I might better not sing that in honor of Bill Clinton." So then I thought, well, I could resurrect the song from 2 years ago in light of what we've just been through, hurricane, but then that's kind of insensitive. So then I thought, well, I think the perfect song would be one that George Washington sings to Hamilton. This is before the end of the Revolutionary War. And in this song, he's encouraging Hamilton and warning him that you better be careful what you do, because no matter what you do, history has its eyes on you. I was younger than you are now when I was given my first command. I led my men straight into a massacre. I witnessed their deaths firsthand. I made every mistake and felt the shame rise in me. And even now I lie awake, knowing history has its own. Oh, from here on in, history has its eyes on you. Whoa, whoa, history has its eyes on you. I wrote an impeachment song. I was racking my brain. I didn't know. I thought Bill and I would have to write a parody of some sort, which I knew that he could probably do. But as a music librarian, I'm researching, and I found something. And it's a song that's kind of new by a composer by the name of Jonathan Colton, and it was featured in a show called The Good Lie. And you can find this on YouTube and watch it later and hear probably a much better version than what I'm getting ready to do. But I just want to say before I sing this that any of the political views in this song do not necessarily represent the views of the performers or of our illustrious speaker. So I'm just going to sing this song. This is called Nobody's Above the Law. And I'm just learning this song. The people made you the president. You get your power from our consent. It's not just a figure of speech. If you do something you shouldn't do, the Constitution will get to you. Congress has power to impeach. Republicans, Democrats, in-betweeners, no time high-rise and misdemeanors. Your tighter hands will stretch you long, but nobody's above the law. Andrew Johnson and Clinton, too. Congress did what they had to do. Nixon resigned just in time. Obstructing justice and perjury, emoluments, Russian puppetry. Treason is also a crime. Republicans, Democrats, in-betweeners, looking for high crimes and misdemeanors. Maybe this will stick in your craw, but nobody's above the law. They vote on the articles in the House of Representatives. A simple majority says if you're impeached. And then there's a trial in the Senate where they consider the charges to vote for you from office. And if they get 2%, you're done and they're gone and you'll never serve office again. Maybe that's why you don't do business with farm spies. You don't keep slush funds. You don't tell lies. History knows what you've done. Republicans, Democrats, in-betweeners, tired of your high crimes and misdemeanors, the founders and the framers foresaw that nobody's above the law, nobody's above the law, even you, nobody's above the law.
Thank you, Dallas. But that was a substitute part of the program. And actually, you stole a good deal of my thunder. Anyway, first, a little bit about Constitution Day and why this is, why we commemorate it today and why it is a day worth commemorating. The Constitutional Convention met from May 25th, 1787, until September 17th, 1787, in one of the hottest Philadelphia summers on record. And one important vote they took on May 25th was to keep the proceedings of the convention secret. And by the way, as a historical note, it remained so until 50 years after the Constitution was passed. James Madison, and I'm going to read from his notes in a second, took the most exhaustive record of the Constitution. Madison, a remarkable figure, had taught himself a kind of a shorthand. And even though he was a major participant in the convention, he took its most exhaustive notes. But the convention did keep its deliberation secret, which meant that they generally met with the windows closed. And I've always wondered, as a student of that proceeding, what they must have worn. If they put the shades down, took their clothes off, how could you bear it? But they did a remarkable job over 4 months of tumultuous debate and remarkable reflection. So the Constitution was essentially finished on September 16th, and on September 17th, an embossed version was brought. By the way, I explained to my students, unlike the Declaration of Independence, which was adopted on July 4th, but the embossed copy that we see in the archive was actually not signed until August 8th later. So I have to say that this is one of my favorite moments from the record, and I have so much of my identity and thought invested in this. This is an emotional moment for me. So as Linda Richman used to say on Coffee Talk on Saturday Night Live, forgive me if I get perplexed. Benjamin Franklin was a participant in the convention, although he was very ill. He was 81 years old and died a few years after the convention. He was so ill that in the time that he spoke, he generally wrote it out beforehand, and of all people, Alexander Hamilton, who was a good friend, of course, read the convention, his speeches in the convention. So, this is from the last day for Madison's notes. The members then proceeded to sign the instrument. While the last members were signing it, Dr. Franklin, looking towards the president's chair, at the back of which a rising sun happened to be painted, observed to a few members near him that painters had found it difficult to distinguish in their art a rising from a setting sun. I have said, he said, often in the course of this session, and the vicissitudes of my hopes and fears as to its issue, looked at that painting behind the president without being able to tell whether it was a rising or setting sun. But now, at length, I have the happiness to know that it is a rising and not a setting sun. The Constitution being signed by all the members except Mr. Randolph, Mr. Mason, and Mr. Gerry, who declined giving it the sanction of their names, the convention dissolved itself by adjournment, sine die. And that is why we celebrate today's Constitution Day. It was the last day of the convention, and the framers, while they anticipated much in American life, did not anticipate a hurricane 2 centuries later, which is why we're doing it today. Now, in some ways, when Dr. Barker approached me this summer to see if I would be the reprise act of Constitution Day, I didn't have to think too hard about a potential topic. And it's in the air, and I, of course, chose that topic. And in an odd way, I'm not going to address the question that everybody has in their mind, sort of. And that question is, of course, should Donald Trump be impeached? Originally, if you look at my sketch for today's lecture, I was going to do something a little dramatic. I was going to do my main thing, which is to present the framers' view of this and what might be the constitutional standards and what we might have learned from the 2.5 presidential impeachments that have occurred in our history. But then I decided, and I was going to actually then become a debate. I was going to bring my older coat and actually put it on to be one of the characters and debate myself and present both sides of the question. I decided to kind of pull back from that a little bit. Probably not enough drama in one day. But my main intention is, again, to sort of take you through how the question of impeachment developed in the Constituent Convention and to see what we could learn from that. As you'll see, the context that I just developed for the convention itself is important for understanding, I think, what the framers thought about impeachment. What I'm planning to do is when I set it up, I'm actually going to read the main notes from Madison on that day. They're relatively short, but they're quite revealing, I think, about what the meaning of this procedure is. So just a couple of preparatory stuff. What the term impeachment means, its procedures in the Constitution, and as you'll see, the most difficult and contentious issue is the standards for impeachment, which is primarily what the framers discuss. Impeach is essentially a synonym for the word indict. It means to accuse. It comes from different Latin words, from either peccare, from sin, to accuse someone of doing something wrong, or a pedicare, actually, to put in the way of someone's foot or to put a stumbling block. The main point is impeachment is a kind of indictment. It's rooted in the British parliamentary historical procedure where the House would, in fact, impeach and often indict people for criminal purposes. You're going to see that the framers adopted that British model but profoundly limited it and transformed it in our Constitution. So what we have in the Constitution is, in essentially, two-step procedure that imitates criminal procedure, which is to say a grand jury procedure where the question is whether or not a trial should occur. And what determines if a trial should occur is there's plausible wrongdoing and sufficient evidence of wrongdoing. And, of course, and the framers then gave that function to the House, and then the Senate then becomes the court where those charges are adjudicated in trial and the question of guilt or innocence is determined. So we have to remember, though, that the framers decriminalized the question of impeachment. And that means, as we'll see, that all the question and controversy are what are the standards for removal. Just a quick rundown of the Constitution's provisions on impeachment. Article 1, Section 5. Section 2, Clause 5. The House of Representatives shall choose their speaker and other officers and shall have the sole power of impeachment. Article 1, Section 3 on the Senate, Clause 6. The Senate shall have the sole power to try all impeachments. When sitting for that purpose, they shall be on oath or affirmation. That is to say, beside their general senatorial oath to support the Constitution from Article 6, they take a specific oath when they're sitting as a court of impeachment to proceed with integrity of the office. It's quite dramatic, actually. When the President of the United States is tried, the Chief Justice shall preside, and no person shall be convicted without concurrence of two-thirds of the majority members present. And from Clause 7, judgment in cases of impeachment shall not extend further than to removal from office and disqualification, as Wendy's song suggested, to hold and enjoy any office of honor, trust, or profit under the United States. But the party convicted shall nevertheless be liable to and subject to indictment, trial, judgment, and punishment according to the law. We're not going to go into this, but that has to do with the delicate question of whether a city, how much a sitting president is subject to a normal court procedure and criminal procedure. I agree. The Constitution doesn't actually spell that out. And as I'll see, some of those issues are very difficult to answer. For instance, just earlier this year, the question came up, can the president pardon himself? And it turns out that's a difficult question to answer. According to the title of Wendy's song, no one is above the law, and therefore it would seem absurd that a president would be able to exempt himself from criminal procedure and judgment. And the president is not above the law. But the problem is that the primary law that contains the president's actions is the Constitution itself. And so really respected authorities on the Constitution could not agree on whether or not the president could pardon himself. So the other constitutional procedure provision is from Article 4 in Section 2, impeachment and removal. The president, vice president, and all civil officers of the United States shall be removed from office on impeachment for and conviction of treason, bribery, or other high crimes and misdemeanors. Treason and bribery have a fairly substantially worked out meaning in our history and jurisprudence. Although even that got tossed into the mix this year when President Trump, in his dual interview with President Putin, seemed to undermine the efforts of his own intelligence community. But again, one would say that language is thrown around, but that's not what most people would gravitate towards, as you'll see, who advocate for the impeachment of the president. Now, to set up the question of impeachment, I think this is an important distinction to make, and I've been thinking about this really for a long time, and it seems appropriate for this question, and that is to reflect on the levels of politics in the American political system. And what I want to suggest is, because of this unique written constitution, it's not unique now, but in 1787, it was the only written constitution in the world besides the state constitutions, which had been formulated after the Revolution. So the presence of the written constitution creates an interesting duality in our political system. On the one level, there's the constitutional level of politics. The function of the constitution is to create the infrastructure of governing, to set up the institutions of government and give them adequate powers to govern and limit their powers and prevent tyranny, and in some ways channel the energies of daily politics, which subsequently follow. So what's that level? I call that the world of politics. What is that world and what are its constituent elements? That is composed of actual questions of policy. What's in the nation's good? What should the nation do to address its challenges? Ambition. One of the interesting things when you look at the framers' design of the Constitution and the documents that support its ratification is how reflective they were. While you can't quite say that the Constitutional Convention was a seminar in political theory or human psychology, there's no question that the drafters of our Constitution took that interesting human factor into account. They knew, for instance, that even in the best of human beings, the presence of personal ambition often distorts a point of view and can lead to interesting consequences in action that would surprise most people. Partisanship. It's interesting when you look at the founding that the same people who generated our constitutional structure, and you have to, again, you have to have a look at their actions and debates in the convention and how they behaved prior to and surrounding it. And one has to come with a certain amount of admiration for the remarkable degree of statesmanship and intellect that went into our founding. And then, interestingly enough, a year later, 2 years, 10 years later, the same people that drafted the Constitution, who then inhabited its offices, seem to have been the most violently partisan and low-level, low-minded people in the world. It's a real irony. So in some ways, you could say that the framers anticipated what even they themselves would become if they occupied the institutions that they designed. Personality. Contemporary politics is to a very real extent determined by the interesting grade of personalities. You can't, for instance, I think, understand our politics without understanding, of course, some of the aspects of the character of Donald Trump. But look at the interesting things that Nancy Pelosi adds to our politics, or Chuck Schumer, or Maxine Waters. So in some ways, that becomes an inseparable element that can often become determinative of important questions in surprising ways. And of course, I'd have to say the last thing is, of course, the struggle that foreign policy and trying to direct the common good of a nation involves. So there you have two levels of reality. The Constitution channels the energies of politics, mostly in routine and predictable ways. For instance, the procedure of legislation, where a simple majority in each chamber passes legislation, it goes to the other house, then it goes to the president, and so forth. There's no question that the framers understood that a good deal of political energy would be channeled in that. And in fact, you could say that in 229 years of looking at the Constitution, we know how those energies play out and what kinds of things to expect. Appointments, the power of appointment, is a fairly routine and important part of politics. So there's no question that the two levels converge in a good deal of American governance. But I would argue, and you're going to see this is important to my understanding of the impeachment issue, other procedures are clearly meant to operate at a distance from immediate political energies and are clearly, I think, intended to be, what you might even call, emergency or rare procedures. How does one know, for instance, when you look at the Constitution, that one kind of procedure or structure is clearly meant to be partisanized or politicized, and another procedure is meant to be withdrawn from or distant from politics? I'd say the two primary structural elements are a difficult procedure. So if you look, for instance, at the procedure requirements for the president, the main difference between that and other officers being impeached is the addition of the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court as the presiding officer. The other constitutional structure that suggests an attempt to distance a procedure from immediate politics is a supermajority. So for instance, overturning a presidential veto, expelling a member of Congress, impeaching anybody, by the way, two-thirds majority to convict in the Senate, passing a constitutional amendment, and ratifying a constitutional amendment. Though that's evidence that the framers knew that you had to try to anticipate as many possible eventualities in the practical world of politics, and there are times when you had to have these kinds of emergency or rare procedures. But again, I think the argument or the suggestion is that I'm making is that they probably knew that those procedures would be rooted in partisan energies, but they tried to set up a procedure where those energies would be either sifted out or tampered. Why would that be? Because there are certain constitutional questions that have to do with the very fundamental presence of an operation of the government. So that's, as you're going to see, I think that's the proper conceptual context for understanding the issue of impeachment. So let's look at the primary statement of the framers on impeachment in the Constitutional Convention. Let me give a little context again. What I'm going to read to you in Madison's notes occurred on September 8th, 1787. Now, at this point, the Constitution was essentially finished. It had gone through several major draftings, two major committees, and in fact, at this very time, from September 5th to September 12th, also historically important is my birthday, which also shows a fourth hand of God in this. You could say the second major committee in the convention was meeting, the Committee on Detail. This was a five-person committee appointed on September 5th, including Alexander Hamilton, Governor Morris, Robert Livingston, and Charles Pinckney, whose primary function was to take the pretty finished rough draft of the Constitution and create its final language. So this discussion that I'm going to read from you took place while this committee was meeting, and had an important bearing on the final language of the Constitution, as you'll see. Now, the two main conceptual developments that you have to keep aware of to see as the background for this are the two major theories of the Constitution that had emerged in the 4 months of discussion and deliberation. The first of those was the emergence of the doctrine of separation of powers and checks and balance as the primary structure of the Constitution that would achieve its primary two purposes. Those two purposes being effective government and the restraint of governmental power in the name of preventing tyranny. It's important to remember because, as part of the debate in the Great Court case, Myers v. U.S. in 1925, which had to do with presidential removal, somewhat tangentially attached to the issue of the impeachment of Andrew Johnson, one of the things that the justices debated was what was the purpose of the separation of powers and checks and balances. Justice Brandeis argued his primary purpose was to prevent tyranny. And it's kind of obvious how that element works. The framers tend to quote Montesquieu, the French political philosopher, as the meaning of tyranny, the concentration of all powers in one set of hands. That's a quote and a phrase that comes throughout the Federalist Papers, and in justifying it, it's easy to see that they mean the separation of powers and checks and balances is how you prevent all concentration of power in one set of hands. But Chief Justice Taft also pointed out, following Hamilton to a certain degree, that remember, the Constitution came into being as a response to the failures of the Articles of Confederation. And the primary failure of the Articles of Confederation was the creation of a government effective enough and efficient enough to govern the country and attain its good. So the structure of separation of powers and checks and balances has a somewhat difficult, combined, tension-ridden purpose, preventing effective government and preventing tyrannical government. By the end of the convention, it was pretty clear to most, and I have to say that as an observer of the convention, as somebody who has studied its proceedings, you can tell that certain public bodies don't always achieve deliberation or move towards deliberation. If you've attended enough faculty meetings, you understand what I mean. The students didn't laugh because they don't know the reality of it. But the interesting thing about the convention is these individuals got more thoughtful about what they were doing as the convention endured. And so that was the first development, the emergence of separation of powers and checks and balances. As you'll see, that's important because that shows some of the problems they struggled with in trying to design the removal power, the impeachment power to remove the president. The second development, somewhat even more surprising and somewhat dependent upon the separation of powers and checks and balances, was the embrace of the strong, independent, powerful executive. Indeed, in the ratification struggle, there were two primary objections to the Constitution. The first one being that it didn't contain a Bill of Rights. The second primary and widespread objection was it had created a potential monarch. Indeed, Patrick Henry, which most people know for giving you liberty or giving you death, was a member of the Virginia Ratification Convention and stood up and thundered, "This institution is the fetus of monarchy." So in some ways, that was kind of counterintuitive, that the convention would create such a strong and powerful executive. Now, again, once you understand the larger framework of separation of powers and checks and balances and the infirmities of the articles, you see why they embraced that. And they were quite clear that that also presented remarkable dangers. You have to say that in 229 years of living under the Constitution, that has been one of the recurring issues. We knew that we created a powerful president, that the growth of institutional development in our country since then has been to empower the president even more. So much so that in 1974, one of the great scholars of the Constitution, Arthur Schlesinger Jr., published a book entitled The Imperial Presidency. So in some ways, that's important background for understanding some of these questions. But as you'll see, that involved a particular question that the convention had to deal with. And that was how to elect a president, and in some ways, how to limit his power by the question of removal. The most available and typical model for a presidential election or executive election that was available for the convention, and which it embraced in the earlier stages, was legislative election. Because of the 11 states, of the 13 states in the original Confederation, 11 had the president elected by, or the governor elected by the legislature. Only two states had independent election of the executive. So in some ways, they structurally embodied the idea of an independent executive by creating the Electoral College. And the Electoral College, by the way, was one of the last features of the Constitution to emerge. They had three models in front of them. Direct election by the people. they just didn't think it was logistically possible. Nor did they think people were qualified to do the actual choice of man. The other alternative would have been, aside from popular election, legislative election. Now, that was the most available model, and as you can see, they moved away from that. That critical question, the abandoning of legislative election and also removal of the president, is the immediate context for understanding the impeachment question. The other model, which they embraced, was a third model, would be a separate institution for electing the president that would do its function and dissolve, and that's where the Electoral College came. So, with that in mind, this was from September 8, 1787. Again, it's relatively short, and as you'll see, it sheds some light. I'll just read the preceding motion. Mr. Jerry moved that no officer should be appointed but to offices created by the Constitution or by law. This was rejected as unnecessary by 6 noes and 5 ayes. Like in the Second Continental Congress, the delegates of the convention voted by state. So when the votes are recorded, they're state votes. Colonel Mason, the question of the trial of impeachments against the president was brought up. Colonel Mason, why is the provision restrained to treason and bribery only? Treason, as defined in the Constitution, will not reach many great and dangerous offenses. Hastings is not guilty of treason. Attempts to subvert the Constitution may not be treason, as defined above. As bills of attainder, which have saved the British Constitution, are forbidden, it is the more necessary to extend the power of impeachments. He moved to add, after bribery and treason, maladministration. Mr. Jerry seconded him. Mr. Madison, so vague a term will be equivalent to a tenure during the pleasure of the Senate. Mr. Gouverneur Morris, it will not be put in, and force can do no more harm. An election of every 4 years will prevent maladministration. Colonel Mason withdrew maladministration and substituted other high crimes and misdemeanors. Mr. Madison objected to a trial of the president by the Senate, especially as he was to be impeached by the other branch of the legislature, and for any act which might be called a misdemeanor. The president, under these circumstances, was made improperly dependent. So let's make sure you understand Madison's objection. He thought that even the term high crimes and misdemeanors, by expanding the purview besides treason and bribery, would give too much discretion to the legislature over the tenure of the president. The president, under these circumstances, was made improperly dependent. He would prefer that the Supreme Court be the trial for impeachments, or rather a tribunal of which that should form part. Let me just remind you, even though the impeachment proceeding in the Constitution is based upon the British model, the framers actually had a good deal of hesitation about pinning this function on the House and Senate. The main alternative was to create a separate, like for the election of the president, would be to create a separate body that would perform that function. Yet they finally decided, perhaps they just wanted to leave at that point, that the best thing to do, an imperfect but preferable solution, was to take the impeachment function and pin it on the Congress, apportioning the functions as I just described. Mr. Gouverneur Morris thought that no other tribunal than the Senate could be trusted. The Supreme Court was too few in number and might be warped or corrupted. He was against a dependence of the executive on the legislature of any kind, considering the legislative tyranny a great danger to be apprehended. But there could be no danger that the Senate would say untruly on their oaths that the president was guilty of crimes and facts, especially as in 4 years he could be turned out. Mr. Pinckney disapproved of making the Senate the court of impeachments as rendering the president too dependent on the legislature. If he opposes the favor of law, the two houses will combine against him, and under the influence of heat and faction, throw him out of office. So, short, but I think somewhat revealing, how would you summarize, but therefore, what we learned from that? One is, they clearly had understood at that point, given their grasp of human nature, that everybody, even somebody entrusted with the highest functions of the government, can go wrong. They just do wrong. They become corrupt. There's a principle of corruption in all of us. By the way, and part of the emergence of the impeachment power had to do with the fact of the creation of the Article III judiciary. Most of you know that the Article III judiciary, Supreme Court, federal judges, are appointed for life. And therefore, they understood that not only with the judiciary, but even other executive officers, there had to be some way, some unusual procedure for removing them. Now, as you're going to see, as it turns out in history, most of the impeachment energies have been directed against federal judges. So, again, they wanted to create a procedure that was difficult, but not impossible. Second, they knew that if you go back to my framework for the intersection of constitutional authority and political issues, they knew that this would often involve the most intense political issues of the day. So their aim was to make sure that those energies, I think, didn't prevail. They understood, in other words, and this is, I think, genius on their part, that the presidential election might be the occasion of remarkable social and political turmoil, but that the removal of a president might generate as much turmoil and confusion as policy. So as you're gonna see, what I mean by that is, I think they tried to create in the procedure a certain weight of the risks of presidential removal. That is to say, the actual decision to impeach would be a balance of the judgment of the amount and character and seriousness of the wrongdoing with the potential damage done by us removing the president. And on the question of presidential removal, the primary procedural difference, of course, is the addition of the Chief Justice as the presiding officer. What that means is that was the kind of compromise between the debate that was going on between Madison and some of the others at the end. Madison wanted the Supreme Court to be the body of trial because of its impartiality, its political independence. Morris thought it was too small and that it had to have more political weight of the nation. So the compromise is to have the Senate be the trial body, but the Chief Justice added as both a serious element and you could say a procedural safeguard. So in history, what's been the reality of the impeachment power? 15 federal judges have been impeached and have gone to trial and have been removed by the Senate, mostly for bribery, corruption of office, a few dashes of insanity and drunkenness here and there, but primarily for corruption of office. Now, of the 2.5 presidents that have been impeached, now, again, just to remind you, this is a procedure that is intended to be available, but rare. The problem with a rare procedure is there is less precedent to guide us in terms of understanding its operation. And in fact, as you'll see when we look at the 2.5 presidential impeachments, the circumstances have been so unique and idiosyncratic, it's almost hard to generalize and to guide, to get a kind of a general standard to apply for future cases. So, Andrew Johnson. The real issue in the background, of course, was the different views of Reconstruction. Oh, and by the way, if you will, let me just interrupt now. Look at the bottom of my notes. I have some interesting sources for you. And by the way, I'll put these on reserve. So if you want to follow up any of these, they'll be available. And
there's a great account of the impeachment of Andrew Johnson in Alan Weltzel's great book on Reconstruction. So understanding his impeachment and trial can't be separated from the surrounding issues of Reconstruction and the different views of how to reincorporate the South back into the American Union. Now, the specific issue was the radical Republicans. Actually, and it's interesting to imagine what U.S. history would look like had Abraham Lincoln survived, because he probably had the presidential stature and the attachments to the Republican Party to withstand some aspects of radical Republicanism, although that's an unknown. And anyway, after Lincoln's assassination, the Tennessee Democrat, Andrew Johnson, of course, became president. Interestingly enough, he had committed himself to Lincoln's view of Reconstruction, which was at odds with the radical Republicans, who wanted a more punitive view and a greater insertion of federal authority. And of course, they won out in some ways. Now, the specific issue was the Tenure of Office Act of 1867. The Congress knew in some ways that as long as President Johnson was in office and had control over the, especially the Department of War and the federal bureaucracy, that he might impose his view of Reconstruction on the administration. So what did they do? They passed a law that required any office that had been appointed with the consent of the Senate to be removed with the consent of the Senate. So the tension came down to the Secretary of War, Stanton, whom Johnson removed. So there were other issues in the impeachment, but basically, it's kind of interesting, the House voted to impeach him with a, this is why I have the number of your lecture notes. Wide majority. 126 to 47. The Senate opened the debate in April, and the trial went through May 16, 1868. And on the final day of the vote, it takes a two-thirds majority to convict. One senator changed his mind at the last minute, and Johnson was saved with a vote of 34 to 16. So what saved him, by the way? When you look at the debates at the trial, the main question was there's no question that Johnson had violated a statute of Congress by removing Stanton. There was some debate about whether or not that statute itself was constitutional. And I think that's what created the edge for his salvation. That is to say, and the question of presidential removal of executive officers was a thorny question at the founding and has continued up until the time, including the removal of James Comey by President Trump. So, by the way, just to tell you that the consensus of the framers, at least in the first Congress, including James Madison, was that the president had sole power to remove all executive officers. And that means that Congress couldn't limit that power. So I think what turned the senator's mind at the end was, although that Johnson had in some ways thwarted Congress and in some ways said, thumbed his nose at it, it wasn't sure if that was not totally, the constitutional case against that was not totally clear. 3 days before I got married, 1974, and I like to tell my students that two national disasters unfolded. Nixon resigned from office. Late in July, the House Judiciary Committee voted three articles of impeachment, including obstruction of justice, abuse of presidential power, and interesting enough, tax evasion. And of course, if you remember those dramatic events at the time, Nixon lost the case U.S. v. Nixon and had to reveal the tapes of the recordings in the executive office. Once those were published, expletives deleted, he quickly understood that the judges were going against him and that the House was about to vote to impeach him, and so he resigned to cut off that question. So remember, we've only actually had two presidents that have been impeached, and of course, he was one of them. With President Clinton, the issue was not his sexual behavior in office, but rather what he had done to cover up that behavior. And on December 19th, 1998, the House voted. Voted by a pretty narrow vote, 220 to 206, to convict President Clinton of perjury and obstruction of justice. The Senate, on the other hand, very decisively rejected that with a vote of 55-45, barely meaning a bare majority. It was interesting. Senator Danny Moynihan, one of those prominent intellectual Democrats of the day, in September of 1998, had been asked the question, would a single charge of perjury or obstruction of justice be sufficient to merit removal from office? He said yes, although he voted no against the resolution in the Senate. So, with that in mind, should Donald Trump be impeached? One of my favorite authorities on the Constitution, although I disagree with the people, is Cass Sunstein. And let me read to you from his manual of impeachment on the question of what it takes to impeach a president. I think this is very interesting advice. He says to the reader, suppose that a president engages in certain actions that to you seem very, very bad. Suppose that you are tempted to think that he should be impeached. You should immediately ask yourself, in italics, would I think the same thing if I loved the president's policies and thought that he was otherwise doing a splendid job? That's a good way of ensuring the requisite neutrality. The impeachment mechanism isn't a way for political losers to overturn the outcome of a legitimate election. Nor is it a way for the public to say, our leader is doing a rotten job. Putting it differently, loathing the president is not sufficient grounds for impeaching him. And the risk is that if you loathe him, you might find certain actions a legitimate basis for impeachment, even if you would find those grounds patently inadequate if you loved him. Here's a second test. Suppose that you do not think that the president should be impeached. You should ask yourself, would I think the same thing if I abhorred the president's policies and thought that he was otherwise doing a horrific job? That's an important question as well. If the president's supporters do not think that he has committed an impeachable offense, they should test their neutrality by asking whether their judgment is being distorted by their political convictions. Here's a third test. And best of all, try to put yourself behind a veil of ignorance in which you know nothing about the president and his policies. You have no idea whether he would win your vote or your support. All you know about are the actions that are said to be the basis for impeachment. If that's all you know, would you think that he should be impeached? I actually think that's a great way to think about this question, even in our present circumstances. So what I'll just do is briefly suggest the yes answer and the no answer. I'll stay in the same code. And then leave it for your questions. There are two issues that tend to support the yes vote for impeachment. One is that President Trump, either on the way to presidency, in the election, or during the presidency, committed palpably criminal acts. The most interesting one developed in the last couple of months that came out of the Michael Cohen panoply, where Cohen argued that Trump directed him to make payments to Trump's mistress to remain undisclosed. So, was that a criminal violation? First of all, don't try this at home. The specific question is, did candidate Trump violate the Federal Election Act by authorizing a campaign fund, a campaign expenditure that was unreported, and et cetera? One problem is, this is not clear. The federal campaign laws are very complex, and it's not clear that that would have been reported as a campaign expense. The second and more difficult question is, can a president, using authorized powers of the presidency, commit criminal acts under that authority? And the specific question, of course, that most people bring to mind is the firing of James Comey. Nobody doubts that the president, in terms of the resolution of the removal question, has the power over executive officers. But did he, in fact, and this usually culminates in the suggestion that President Trump is guilty of obstruction of justice, and he's trying to cut off the investigation into the collusion with Russia question. But that's a difficult question. And that, as you'll see, leads to the no question. The most interesting person to read here, by the way, is Alan Dershowitz, who's kind of a center-left lawyer and has written a book, interesting enough, called The Case Against Impeachment of Trump. His argument is one, that none of Trump's actions beforehand reached the level of criminality, and two, that the president, in using duly constitutional powers, can't be held accountable for the use of those powers. If you go to the interesting website, Need to Impeach, who's under the auspices of Tom Steyer, the California billionaire who's really been quite public, and you'll see I listed some of the interesting articles that he's published. His argument is that the pardoning of Joe Arpaio was actually an unconstitutional pardon. And the problem with that is again, the president has the power of pardon, and the Constitution doesn't give many guidelines for that. There have been many, many controversial pardons throughout our 229 years. So in some ways, you can see how somebody might go yes on that, no on that, but part of that depends on the larger context. So on that difficult question, should the president be impeached? It's up to you. Thank you. Yes, President Kirk. Oh, that never happened.
Yeah, I'm still trying to think through everything that you're saying. It's an interesting choice, and I like the three tests that were put forward by.
Yeah,
it's very interesting. To go back though to Nixon's impeachment, Nixon was impeached for the tapes that were possibly an influence of the election, and yet Nixon won by a landslide.
True.
The issue here is one of did this truly influence the election, either the president through Cohen or the meetings with Russians and the false news that was put out through Russians and such. And in this case, it's not clear whether that did have an influence on the election. How do you parse all of that out as process?
About Nixon, by the way, because it's interesting because one of the same charges shared by President Clinton was obstruction of justice. I think it's probably unquestionable that had the impeachment process gone to its completion, Nixon probably would have been tried and would have been the first president from office. Why? What was the difference between the obstruction of justice issue with Nixon and then we'll get back to the question of the election. The obstruction of justice charge with Nixon had to do with the using of the whole executive, the apparatus of the executive branch to cover up the Watergate burglary. And therefore, in some ways, I think that both the political weight of judgment about the way he was being president with the constitutional standard came to, even in many Republicans' minds, is this, that Nixon had so warped the powers of the presidency in a criminal conspiracy and cover-up that in fact he reached the standard. Because again, the ambiguity is this interesting language, high crimes and misdemeanors. I just had this discussion last night with a lawyer friend, a Jewish lawyer friend of mine in Philadelphia. High crimes and misdemeanors seems to be something of an oxymoron. We think of crimes and misdemeanors, and we think misdemeanors as a low level of criminality, and then high, what's a high misdemeanor? And if you go back to the original discussion, even though they avoided the more general term maladministration, it's clear that that kind of still finds its whiff of that. So what's the standard? If the president uses his powers in such a concerted way that he begins to threaten the operation and balance of constitutional structure, that's a high crime and misdemeanor. You could argue that Clinton, both in terms of the perjury and obstruction of justice, was attempting to save his public reputation by covering up a sexual misdemeanor or something like that. I think the country probably judged that that wasn't as serious a challenge to the constitutional order as Nixon's behavior. On the question of Trump, first of all, since I think what you meant to say was the covering up of his affair with Stormy Daniels. Clearly, the payments to her removed that as a factor in the public mind in the election since it didn't come out until later. So to put your question together, Nixon won by a 62% majority, which was one of the highest majorities in our history of a presidential vote. And Trump squeaked by in the Electoral College. And is it possible? On the collusion question, I have to say, there doesn't seem to be much evidence that...
Not yet.
Yeah, and by the way, that's a good point. But that the Trump campaign helped to engineer either the release of Clinton's documents or the fake news engineering. This is still a problem, by the way. So in some ways, I think that's a hard question. My guess is if this were to come to impeachment, if the Democrats win in November, and the energy for impeachment, because it's very strong in the Democratic base, and I think, by the way, both people who defend Trump and who support Trump should go back and read Sunstein's statement, I think it's a fine statement, the issues, I think, would be less, frankly, leading up to the idea of violating law by violating federal campaign law. Again, but that is so complex. And even a fine lawyer like Dershowitz said there's no case there. That it wasn't a campaign expense. It might have been lamentable, but it wasn't a direct campaign. I mean, you can see the minutiae.
Mm-hmm.
But probably I think the weight of impeachment against Trump would be his conduct after the election and in some ways the use of his powers. So did I answer your question?
I think it'll be interesting to see, though, what comes, I mean, if anything could manifold. I mean, I think if he testifies and if there's more there with the actions with the Russian lawyer and the Manafort's interesting history of using fake news in elections overseas, and if that was then utilized in this case, then I think that probably gets closer to an action that threatens a democratic process.
The legitimacy of the election.
That's right.
Well, it's probably...
There's a lot of ifs.
But if you look at the two main other circumstantial figures, Manafort and Cohen, it doesn't seem to be much in Cohen's stuff that would push back towards Russian collusion or anything. It's mostly, it has to do with the cover-up money for the affair. The Manafort seems to hinge on that July meeting. And so my guess is if that becomes part of the issue, it will be an attempt to reconstruct exactly how influential, what went on in that meeting, which we get different versions of, by the way. He was at that meeting, and that's the main connection with the Russian thing, that meeting. It doesn't seem, because he was so tangential in the campaign otherwise, but was still active in the campaign at that point.
Yeah.
So I think it will turn on how much comes out about that meeting and whose narrative of that meeting the House and or Senate comes to believe.
I think the really interesting constitutional issue that you raised is when a president is acting within his powers, but that action could warrant a judicial process or something, such as the removal of Comey, which is clearly within his powers,
right,
but threatens an independent investigation potentially. At what point does that amount to a threat to the constitutional process and thus a type of crime ongoing?
And I think
that's a really interesting question.
That is, I think, actually the main question.
Yeah.
And in some ways, it gets back to the very tension-ridden nature of the impeachment process. This is not a criminal procedure, and oftentimes you don't have the clarity, not by the way the criminal procedures always generate clarity, even in terms of conviction or anything, but you could say the framers knew that some kind of political judgment would be involved in this. And so in some ways, whether or not that crossed a bar in impeachment depends upon whether or not you think that his actions, even if they were legitimate within the constitutional power, nevertheless led to a situation that threatened the constitutional balance. And that's ultimately, and this is the difficulty, that's a political judgment. It's not so much looking at what actually occurred, but rather what that might lead to or whether that's a larger web of constitutional undermining.
Well, and that comes back to exact maladministration or some part of it. But then I think what's interesting is what gets layered on this is the Department of Justice's internal memo that they will not move forward with an indictment of the sitting president because they leave that to the impeachment process, which also means that his charges aren't always brought to light.
Well, and that's again, that's part of the tension of the way our Constitution is constructed. we put the constitutional function of prosecution and indictment in the very branch that is controlled at this point by the object, the potential object of that. I think the framers were aware of that tension. And the solutions that we have adopted as a nation, like the special prosecutor or the independent counsel, though they themselves are problem ridden. That memo in the Justice Department, and this is part of the controversy of interpreting the nature of the presidency and his powers, that memo represents a fairly wide consensus of several generations of the Department of Justice that the president, even though Lindy Song suggests that nobody's above the law, that certain aspects of normal criminal procedure don't apply to him. So I must admit that your question is, but doesn't that mean that certain indictable offenses might therefore go unexamined or something?
Yeah.
It's kind of a chicken and egg thing.
Yeah.
You have to have some kind of criminal investigation that might persuade the House that there was a sufficient grounds for impeaching. And if the president is removed, then the question of indictment and criminal procedure, then, because the Constitution says if you're removed from office by impeachment, you're fully liable for any crimes that you may have committed. Yeah, Laura.
Can you be charged for those crimes after you leave office?
Yes.
Okay.
With nothing. He worked for nothing. I've always wondered.
So do I, but I mean,
I've always wondered.
Oh, president. I should probably be more discreet when I say that. Go ahead.
I've always wondered if somebody else might have been paid. And if someone else might have been paid, who might that be? And would that therefore be legitimized? Say, there's a Russian connection. Would that
Well, when you say Russian connection, again, people imagine different versions of that. There's the actual collusion with like the release of Clinton's email records and that kind of stuff. The social media thing is even harder to prove. But your suggestion is if Manafort had some kind of, and by the way, one of the charges against him, I think, is failing to register as an agent of a foreign government.
That's my point.
My top-of-the-head answer is that it would not lead to a delegitimization of the election. It would lead to an intensification of his criminality or the sense of it. But again, in terms of the overall conduct of the campaign, he became a top player by the summer of 2016. So I think it would. So I guess my answer to your question is no. I don't think that itself would lead to a larger delegitimization.
Look at a football game. Where?
What's a football game?
One side runs the score up
by having an
ineligible player. They take him out, and the other team then starts to score points. But the game is over before the score can be reversed. The fact that they had an illegitimate player scoring the points delegitimizes the outcome of the game.
You may be addressing your question to the most uniquely unqualified person to understand sports analogies. I know those people who look like apes in tights are doing something on the field other than making millions of dollars. So I see what you mean to say is, what if you adopt an illegitimate play that on your side and you win the game? Does the illegitimate play invalidate the results of the game? That's your again, I think that in this context, I would argue that the dynamics of the election weren't probably, and I think this would probably be the results, probably, because you're right, we still don't know, that hasn't all come out yet, that probably the results of the election weren't decisively influenced by any potential Russian code connection, either on Manafort's part or what might come out in terms of the campaign, which means what did determine the election in 2016. I think larger dynamics and problems in both candidates' characters in some ways. And there's some, not to editorialize on the firing of Comey, but you have to remember that when Trump fired Comey, Comey had become a fairly unsavorable character in both sides of the aisle. The Republicans were mad at him for their argument that they exonerated Clinton. The Democrats were mad at him for having raised the issue of her emails again 2 weeks before the election. It may be that Comey's action actually had more influence on the outcome of the election, although it's hard to say. So I guess my general response would be, if you did an illegitimate play in the game, I'm on thin ice here. It's hard to say. That is to say, if the illegitimate thing itself decided the outcome of the game, that I think could be grounds for overturning the game. If it turns out that that your illegitimate action didn't decisively contribute to the outcome of the game, that might be a reason for changing your jersey. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It's really a value check.
Well, to go back to President Newkirk's question.
You're saying it's a no harm, no foul judgment, to some extent.
I'm not sure if I'm saying that or not. Well, isn't it true? Isn't it true in sports that you could do bad things, right? Yes.
Bad things happen, yeah.
But isn't it true that some bad things might affect the outcome, and that they're weightier?
And some things we say, regardless of whether they affect the outcome, they're so bad we're going to remove a medal or take back
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah.
But some things we say, well, it didn't really affect the outcome, so what difference does it make? I think the question is, which of these is this? Is
correct.
This a,
You use the term value judgment. I want to connect that with your earlier comment question. It turns out that I think it's very difficult, aside from these general outlines that come out of the convention and some in history, it's very difficult to say beforehand what clear criteria for impeachment or removal would be. The framers knew, again, that there would have to be political, use the value judgment. I would say a political judgment. And so I guess in sports it would be how much the foul or the bad action, how bad it was, and whether it contributed to the outcome. In politics it would be whether or not this action of the president was so serious that it undermined the integrity of the constitutional system and the proper performance of the executive. Does that make sense? I want you to know how difficult this was. Thank you so much.
So, Jeff, here's the question, man. Is there any circumstance that you can imagine whereby an election might be overturned after the president has taken the oath of office, where it could be bad enough that you could say this election was counted wrong, there was some sort of bribery? Is that possible in our system?
First of all, it's important to remember the Constitution does not contain a procedure which became fairly widespread in some state constitutions around the time of the Progressive Era, and that is recall, which is to say to have an election to undo an election. I think the reason the framers put, and by the way, this is not just my opinion, one of the finest, if you look on the list of sources, I actually think the single best book you should read, if you're going to read any of those works, is by Charles Black on impeachment. Black was a great commentator on the Constitution at Yale Law School, and his argument was the impeachment of the president is essentially undoing the judgment of the American people, and therefore has to be undertaken at very grave risk. Now, on the question, might something come out just after the president has taken the oath of office that would so impugn the legitimacy of the election? Well, one, it's important to remember that you're undoing an election. On the question of Trump, the interesting question is what the American people knew about Trump. When the plurality of the American people voted for him. And the unknown is whether if I were a scientist, I would create a metric by which one could measure the sleazeosity of a human being and then say, might there not be some aspect of Trump's behavior prior to the election which would be so out of tune with American ideals of fair play and expectations in elections, open debate, so I would say this. If it turns out that would question the legitimacy of the election, that would be, I think, opening the door to impeachment and removal somewhat wider. Did that answer your question?
Well, I'm thinking theoretically about whether or not
in one sense, then there's, even if it were to be found that that whatever happened actually affected the election, the removal of the president would simply mean that the vice president
could
step up. That's not a reversal of the election.
That's a good point, by the way. And I have to say that both people who defend Trump and oppose him often don't think it through to that. But you're quite right. Ever since the 12th Amendment, the election of the president, vice president, and senator became a combined ticket. I must admit, that's a fine comment. It reinforces my general appreciation of you as a somewhat thoughtful person. And therefore, by the way, a fine interim department chair. So let me just summarize what you said, because I think that could be an important point in emerging discussion. Since the vice president and president are elected on a ticket, the removal of the president would not necessarily undoing the election itself. That's a very interesting take, I think.